Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another edition of Tanim Graun, Papua New Guinea's Q&A series to encourage public dialogue, debate, and engagement on our development challenges and the opportunities facing our nation, and how you and I as citizens can help to shape that. My name is Alan Bird, and I'll be your host. Today's discussion is fisheries, ensuring its sustainable future. Now, many of us might be familiar with this fishing thing, but in terms of PNG, we want to look at the whole discussion and why it's important. And the key to this particular discussion is sustainability. Here with us to assist in this discussion so we can learn a bit more, on my right-hand side, I have Mr. John Aini. Now, John is the founder of Island Awareness, which is an NGO based in New Ireland, and he flew all the way here to join us on this discussion. Please give him a hand. And we are very privileged to have Mr. Camillus Narakobi, who is actually a maritime law expert. Now, for those young people in the audience and those around the country, Mr. Narakobi wrote The Law of the Sea, and this might be a good read for some of you. Please make him welcome. We're very lucky to have Nancy. Nancy Sullivan has a PhD, and she's a cultural anthropologist. She's based in Madang, and she has particular interest in the maritime, the PMIZ, which is the Pacific yes. Marine yeah. Industrial Zone in Madang. Please make her feel welcome. And the lead agency for fisheries in our country, we now have Mr. Ludwig Kumoru. Ludwig is the acting managing director for NFA. Please make him feel welcome. We have also Ms. Maria Cruz Cristobal. Oh, I pronounced that correctly, thank you. She's head of political press and information at the European Union delegation to Papua New Guinea. Please make her feel welcome. And of course, a man who needs little introduction, the man behind Namorong blog, Mr. Martin Namorong. Now, some of you may have read Papua New Guinea's Vision 2050. The Vision 2050 talks about some critical assets, and one of them is fisheries. Now, recently also, the government launched the Responsible Sustainable Development Strategy. That also puts fisheries right up at the top in terms of its critical importance to Papua New Guinea's future. Now, today, we want to look at fisheries as one of those drivers that will assist the country long after all the oil and gas has run out. Now, I'm going to do something unusual and start with you, Nancy.
No, that's good.
So what do you think? You've been involved with fisheries, you've been fighting for fisheries, you've been...
Well, my word is I'm concerned because I'm a conservationist and, you know, people know me as an anthropologist, so we're worried about labor issues and health and safety issues, and we're the people who put in the first RD Tuna report, and we've worked on a number of fisheries issues. My concern is that the macroeconomics of our industry are not melding well or not articulating well with the microeconomics, you know, in the coastal fisheries. And although Mr. Kumru earlier said something about how the whole of the industry may be looking to phase out tuna, which would be a very good thing, my concern is tuna primarily, you know, and its sustainability in the future.
Mr. Kumru, obviously she's talking tuna. Maybe for the audience you might want to run down all of the different things that live in the sea that have an economic value for us, and your role in that.
Yeah, but thank you. Basically, fisheries is responsible for all marine resources that have economic value. It's not about conservation, it's about utilizing the resource in such a way that you're leaving enough adults of that population so that those adults are able to replenish what have been taken out. But while we do that, we have to make sure that the population benefit economically so that they improve their livelihoods.
I'm told we have about, what, 12 to 14% of the world's tuna all the world's tuna in Papua New Guinea, is that correct?
About
15%. So 15% of the world's tuna live in Papua New Guinea waters.
Live in Papua New Guinea waters. So if that's called for 15% of the world's tuna, that is even, it's a fishery that is bigger than any fishery in the world. The tuna, the biggest tuna fishery in the world is actually in Papua New Guinea.
How
the
much is it worth?
The last free-range tuna is in Papua New Guinea. The last free-range tuna.
Wild tuna?
Wild tuna.
In PNG?
Yeah, it's right offshore towards, you know, the Solomons, between the Solomons and
not only Solomon, it's actually in the whole Western Pacific, including the other Pacific countries. But it's what's being known now as the last frontier.
How much is the tuna worth to Papua New Guinea annually?
Well, in Papua New Guinea, annually, on an average, it's about 550,000 metric tons that we catch in PNG waters. In 2010, which was the highest catch we did, was 720,000 metric tons.
What is the tuna worth?
The tuna is worth, well, rough estimate. If you multiply 550,000 times the fish price, when it was high about a couple of months ago, was $2,000 per ton. So that would have been worth, I don't know, 500,000 metric tons times $2,000.
Over $1 billion. How much of that money do we make as a country?
As a country, at the moment, what we are getting from it is only about 300 million.
Kina or dollars?
In Kina.
Kina.
I'm jumping in here.
Yeah.
I'm jumping in
it's
here.
Okay, you can
these
make
are
a
funny
comment
numbers.
Later.
These are funny numbers because it depends entirely on the second generation embedded, you know, processing plants on shore. And we don't really have reliable numbers on how because as I was saying before, there we've under capacity, you know, in the processing. So we really can't say we're gonna make billions. Everybody uses that treble the raw fish number. But when you think about the economic costs to the villages that are hosting these plants, the social costs to the villages, the ecological costs as well, and factor in all the things. And we know that none of these plants have fully embedded in the local economy. Then we know we really aren't tripling our, you know, our value added. We're really adding very, very little value. In fact, some would say taking value away.
Some can argue that, but I think it depends on how we connect to the opportunities that are created. If we don't take hold of the opportunities that are created by these adventures, then we miss out. Yes, it's not something that somebody has to reinforce you. I mean, there are opportunities created like in, how do you call that, spin-offs, employment.
Mr. Aini, I'm going to drag you into this discussion. You're sitting quietly over there. You've come all the way from New Island. You're hearing the discussion. What do you think?
I've come all the way from Cape Town not to talk about tuna.
That's interesting.
Tuna is a subject that is the national government benefits from that. We don't see it go right down to us. I'm yet to discuss with the panel about the inshore fisheries, which are they contain the resources that are directly impacting our very little people in the village. So, yeah, that's why I'm here. But yes, we will contribute to tuna if need be. But I'm all about inshore fisheries, I'm all about bech-der-mer, I'm all about reef fishery, you know. The very resources that were there are here and must be there for generations to use in future.
Could each of you give us an explanation of what fisheries is, and from your perspective, and given PNG's responsible sustainable development strategy that makes the importance of fisheries to PNG, what stake is this sector in? Installation getting value for money from you.
Thank you, Bartholomew. I think that comes back to what we're discussing. And Bartholomew's question is Papua New Guinea getting value for money from this sector? Camillus, in your opinion, do you think Papua New Guinea is getting value from all our fish? Fishery stocks being harvested. What do you think? Are we getting value?
I think the answer is, simple answer is not quite, not enough. And let me tell you that the Arctic canary exports to European Union market was actually my design. We did the paperwork for United Nations to certify before the exports to, for European Union to accept our exports to European Union. But the value is not sufficient. In other words, the rate of return to the economies of Papua New Guinea is not enough. The most important thing is to feed the nation's populations. So we are concentrating more on the exports rather than feeding our populations. This is the hardest problem we have now. For instance, the prawn fishing in Gulf Papua, it has collapsed because we concentrate too much on exports of prawns to Japan. We have not concentrated on feeding our own populations. That's the problem.
You know, the NFA has done a very, very good job of instituting the Vessel Day Scheme and all kinds of other monitoring systems, you know, and they're hailed in the South Pacific for their work. But we just don't have enough people out there in the high waters. And if we invite more of these vessels from other countries where they have absolutely nothing at stake for us, no interest in our welfare, no interest in paying us well, no interest in providing spin-off businesses, no interest in providing infrastructure,
okay,
or schools or medicine, then
we'll discuss that. We'll come back to that. Let me now, and this is important, let's have a look at a talk out, okay, and then we'll come back and discuss unregulated fishing later.
Study my island awareness long 1993, long time I been working at one of the fisheries. Reason why I study my island awareness and one local NGO, because meeting government, you know, been look inside long sample work where all this work should mark long line long place. Long course long work long one of the fisheries, me as a stock assessment surveyor. Me looking also me got decline long fish stocks, no marine resources also in fish llama, trochu shell, na use long all poison, na poison rope, na destructive fishing methods. And me think also say government, you know, reach out to long all people long talk save long all say on them something me play work him now. Me plan nothing in future. Like for example, suppose you put in poison rope inside long solwara, you know sabe long ol bagara poison rope you bring him inside long solwara. Long time fisheries you talk no can kiss him peace lama long night. All money no sabe long reason why. So long all this la reason that's all, na decline long stock, na meeting all some plenty money need long awem or long all management or conservation issues, long all marine resources blah blah, me study my land awareness. Now, basically, work me plan make him long go long all community na talk save long all long ino good plan long termoy plastic long solwara, ino good plan long using poison rope long kissing peace, ino good plan long kissing peace or kinda megat kiao, all those simple things are. In 2005, I was fortunate to get sample assistant si kamlong ADB. This is a project I've been fisheries na ADB been work one them. I'm long coastal fisheries management program na only funding my land awareness now long formalizing this road show na long promoting community based fisheries management. After some time now, we starting Rangua Solwara School. And so school ya emblong run animal workshops kisimol sumatinikam na teachimol basic biology, ecology, marine management, conservation, long all natural environment na special focus long emblong solwara. But today me play no na why solitim terrestrial environment when them solwara because long all effects long bush unplanned development, unsustainable development long bush. You got effect blowing long marine ecosystems. Now, you affecting production, longol santing lo selwara. For example, there's this ocean that was created. It works its way and to sustain itself properly without introduction of foreign matter. We have got oil palm development in New Ireland. We have mining in New Ireland. Now the Solwara too mining in New Ireland. And we have massive raping of our forest. We also have this problem now of the special agriculture business list in which our own elites have capitalized on our ignorance to sell our land to Malaysia. This is the example right now in UNOVA. 75% of our land has been taken through this land grab thing, through SABLR. And even we have documents of purchase and sales of our land purchased by Malaysians. And like I said, unsustainable logging practices has dramatic impacts and effects on the marine environment. And not only the marine environment, it should make long life sin down lumipla. You know, long time mi play angry. Mi play like mabus, mi play kota solong solwara, kisim pisa. Long time mi play like liglik kakay, mi play kisim liglik green ta solong busa. It is getting harder these days with all this unplanned work that is has been doing. And more to that, for whose benefit? I think the government needs to listen, because some of the decisions that government has made has not done in was not done in consultation with our people. When the government decides or make decisions or allows people to exploit whatever resource we have, long time every come up, every no kisim every online long place by kisim ah. Every long logging, every long water, you know, good plab long drink, every long rip, e karma long dead long ground. Government, you know, kissing this levy. Government, you know, save long pili maybe. Me plan long line long place by kissing maybe. Me plan by kissing time long pine in peace. Me plan by pine in paya buta. And so, I think the government should start talking. Nai come down long level long me plan long place. Nai save long all every me plan karma. Me plan talk talk, brother. Long all this la something, That's all. In any decision we make on me plus top him all, government will still win, Because I know, me no sabe, he need money long run him la country or run him all pocket long. So, yeah, they need to start listening to the very people only affected long, all heavy, long slow work development.
What a beautiful place you have there, my brother. And I like the questions you ask, and I think maybe the panel could respond to that. Let's talk about that. Interesting, he's focused in the village, he's able to draw a line connecting some of the activities that are going on which are impacting on the fisheries there. So who wants to go first?
I'll jump in. It's actually correct in the sense that the whole nation is now getting away from what it's supposed to face, which is its own people, populations of this country. Likewise, in the islands areas, this is happening also. So he's quite right. We have to forget the economics of it and concentrate on humanity, social aspects of our needs and our requirements, which is feeding the people of this country. There is no point in exporting to Japan, exporting to wherever, when you cannot feed your own people. So coastal fisheries is important. Terrestrial fishery, aquaculture is very, very important. Like I said, We only talk about tuna here. We haven't even touched the broad range of fisheries resources in this country. Tilapia in Sipik is so large, nobody knows what to do with it.
It's being killed by the...
And same thing goes for Gulf province and Western province. Mm. Barramundi is dying because of mining activities in Octeti. There is no doubt about it, that Octeti mine has an effect, direct effect, on the sustainability of Barramundi resources. And that mine is not only Barramundi, but because Barramundi is only part of the food chain. The other fish that depends on Barramundi, the other creatures in the ocean that depends on Barramundi. Mm. So they're all affected. The food chain is caught up in this hunger, starvation, for greed for money.
How do we monitor and control the illegal and unregulated fishing in our 2.4 million square kilometers fisheries zones, and what does policy exactly consist of?
And how do we grab illegal, unregulated fishing by the scruff of the neck?
I think Mr. Kunro has an incredible, just to jump in here quickly, he's got an incredible, vision. Is that if we are controlling the high waters, if it is our people, our fishermen, you know, the reason why the Filipinos and the Thai are out there is because on a regional level, people know that they've killed their own industry and that they need the jobs. Well, we don't care. They no longer care. They don't care about giving our women minimum wage. Why should we care about whether they get the jobs in the high seas? And the only reason why we can't police that is because those are foreign vessels out there.
This discussion so far has been, when we talk about fisheries and its panel so far, has been treating it like, well, tuna. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
When we're starting to this discussion on policing, ensuring the laws are being enforced, it is just tuna. That's the way this panel is going on. Mm. We need to draw a fine line here where tuna, internal revenue for this country, and what directly impacts our people in the communities. Mm. When are we going to talk about policing bech-der-mer? When are we going to talk about NFA assisting or local level government assisting with destruction of the marine environment, putting deer's root, polluting of the marine environment at that level?
Thank you very much, John. Okay.
The only way it would work is for us, as John said, is to work together, NGOs, the communities. And that's why we're trying to, with the new management plan for bech-der-mer, it's actually decentralized. It's the local level government who has to work on this. Exactly as John described. We want to put the onus back on the local communities to actually be able to manage this. But that dialogue has to work.
Yes,
we have
yes.
to really work between the local communities, come to the next level, to the provinces. And we have this provincial management committee something, and then they have to link back to the national government. Mm. So once we can get this thing done, we have people becoming to be responsible for their own reefs, for what happens in their own place.
I think that is the way to go.
When we look at it as a national thing, everybody thinks it belongs to NFA. Mm.
No.
And they don't want to be responsible for their own doings. Mm.
Mm. No.
That's the key word, Ludwig. And on that note, let's go to another talk out. Let's look at some... let's listen to some of the fishermen from New Ireland.
Inside the fisheries, you got all like all courses now something where MLP all man all work the fish long all la. Where all Coleman block all short courses like seafood handling, post harvest operations. And assembly all like courses can where MLP all how look out the more na come up a fish businessman. But when it comes to funding now, the only program where all eligible applicants were only good for writing proposal now only can go through this NFA funding by National Fisheries, but lo provincial fisheries na lo ya em adliklik mi bla sampla oklo traem lu ya ba mi bla benefit in sai lo disla. Only up I think only big blo baya blo mi bla lo province na we mi bla ol kata wo lo traem lo regime ma NCS but you got all requirements wo lo safety side we all strict lo food control lo ngolem I think all qualified man da solo li eligible lo go inside so em ol kind lik lik fisa men mi bla sim out fish lo ngol na mi bla traem regime go antapa market if mi bla can make him but distance can na cost them very high e mad lo kind little man also lo rhythm li remi expensive too much mi pla been start of last year mi pla okay about 8 trips going to lo lir finish good pla opportunity am stop we got all good blood chances where you can kiss him good blood price. He go low, or local people straight low. But it's a legal company, I'm start of M yet. So I need him some like and support somewhere where we can consistently operate him this law. Because even low NCS, fish is still high demand, I'm stop yet. But low regime now, you need him this law kind of opportunity where we can go down long or local people where. Only some fish lo good lo price. We all let you harvest locally. Na you me help lo put him na processing fish lo quality we all a higher level like NCS by accepting lo feeding lo workman lo.
It's interesting because they're not talking tuna there.
What are some of the challenges exporters face in trying to get their product to overseas export markets? And how is government assisting them, especially small startup businesses?
Now, normally this sort of thing would just go straight to NFA, wouldn't it? Yeah.
We had a couple of fisheries we tried to develop couldn't kick off because of the cost. For example, the aquarium trade. You get little ornamental fish in tanks and yeah.
Sea Smart.
Yeah, that was under the Sea Smart project we had. That couldn't go on because and you're gonna kill us with freight. They're charging too much. We couldn't compete with fish from Indonesia and Philippines. And, we had this long line for a long time. We struggled, we tried to promote it and based our operations in up north because the catch rates up north are good, even in New Britain. Couldn't operate because the freight systems were not really couldn't take the fish quality wasn't that good after they brought it in. And of course the cost was high. So those sort of things. But the other challenge that what we are trying to do with some of the fishermen to encourage them is that we take them to seafood shows. We got to take part in seafood shows. So we take businessmen to go and showcase their products. And a couple have been very successful. For example, the lobster fishery in Daru, now they're exporting live to Australia and they also export to US now. And just today we got an email from one company in Australia, they want fillet reef fish from PNG because they saw the display of PNG fish in Boston seafood. So we've got our guys at the office to organize with the fishermen, those people having businesses here to see how we can mobilize and supply the fillets to Australia.
What about them? And we're talking export, but yeah. For small businesses, what about the local market? I mean, Papua New Guinea is going to have the largest growth in GDP this year and next year. What about the local market for fish? Is there anything you're doing to say help fishermen, say from New Island, sell fish locally? Or
this market, there's also a very big demand locally, in the local market, but. We can't meet it. We still need to mobilize fishermen and get them to think that they have to really produce a lot and consistent supply. For example, I think it was the LNG. At one stage, they wanted 2 tons of fish a week. Nobody could produce and supply them the fish, so they had to end up importing from somewhere else. So it's a mobility thing again. We need to get down and really start mobilizing local fishermen.
We're a country of very smart people who made a stupid decision to give a monopoly on fuel, and that we are going to deal with for the next 20 years. And our fishermen who need fuel to run the motor boats, in many parts of Papua New Guinea, you need the fuel to run generators for ice facilities. And if the cost of fuel is very high because we have a monopoly, then you know, how can we compete with the rest of the world to export?
Well, maybe that's the verdict on our smartness there, right there, by making a decision like that. But let's move to another question. That's a good point you make.
How is the NFA supporting the aquaculture industry up in the islands, and what does the future hold for PNG's aquaculture industry?
The aquaculture has been pushed from NFA. We support the aquaculture training center in Ayura. We fund that one, and we train farmers in that center. And also not in the center, but there are other different centers that we train people. We have officers who go and train them. And even in Mosby alone, we have a little project up in Suriname, in the dam, we have cage cultures. Our efforts were able to work with the locals there, and they set up a little, not a little, but they have cage cultures. They're looking after tilapia, and the locals, they sell their tilapias to supermarkets and the local markets there. But there, we are doing all this, and not only that, but we also have seaweed farming now, in trial in Milling Bay, and also in Bougainville. So we're taken off in a big way now. Mm. Price going at, what is it, $1,000 per ton. So they're exporting straight to China.
Okay, let's bring this discussion. We're coming close to the end there.
Yes.
You go ahead.
No, I just want to add to what NFA said. NFA is involved because there was money set aside under the Tuna Treaty. Don't forget that. NFA was able to now project what we stood for when we negotiated the Tuna Treaty. So if only the country had set aside money for this purpose, see how far we would have gone in fishing. It's been concentrated on foreign fishing. We have not been concentrating on our own fishermen, our own domestic needs, and our inside needs. For instance, the provinces that are not hinterland provinces. So that's what the future holds. Actually, the fisheries has the biggest potential in this country. Yeah. Just think about it. We have not yet touched other types of fisheries other than tuna, all the reef fish in the country, all the sedentary fisheries in the country, all the anadromous species in the country, all the catadromous species in the country. We have not even scratched a single bit in that area. So we have future, very big future in this country to export. But first of all, we must grow the industries. So we must put money where our mouth is, that is to grow, allow Papua New Guineans to generate revenue commercially. And then they will see the need to export.
Let me come back to this basic question. Is what we are doing now, our current practices in, we'll start with tuna and then I'm looking at you, John. I know you're going to jump across with the coastal fisheries soon, but be patient. Yeah. With tuna, is what we are doing now and into the near future sustainable? And are we being responsible in the way we are dealing with our tuna? Now, I know, Martin, you're shaking your head, but I'm going to start with Ludwig first before I come to you, Martin.
Okay. The way we are going now, first of all, we are not even Camilo said, it's just a surface we are scratching. We haven't even realized the real potential of tuna. As far as sustainability is concerned,
We are now fixing up with the help of EU through the yellow flag, of course. We need some whip. We've sorted out all our management regimes, our act. And the way it's going, the way we have now focused, I think in the next 5 years, we should see or even our production doubling.
Let me stop you and just rephrase that a little bit. In terms of your approach the last, say, 20 years or so, and this new approach that you are taking, what's the difference there?
I think the difference is that we focus more on growing the industry now. In the past, it has been just about getting money from licenses. It doesn't go a long way. You're just getting money, and tomorrow you're hungry, you want the boat again to give you money. But what we are trying to do now is to create an industry, because this industry actually employs a lot of females as well. And we know that when the money goes to women, they can look after their children.
They cannot look after their children when they're online.
Yeah, the pay is terrible.
They cannot look after their children when they're online. Because we are absolutely besotted with this idea that, you know, a job, any job is okay. But this is the high standard of living in Papua New Guinea, especially in coastal communities, is so high that these women volunteer to go online in order to get themselves.
I didn't say women working in factories.
I'm mad.
When you come to employment, any form of employment, as long as it's created by this opportunity.
Well, let's be sure that employment is a sustainable livelihood, is an actual living wage for people.
Yeah.
Because, and I have nothing against that, but I think the canneries themselves are the wrong industry for us to be going in. Because think of all the value added we can get in coastal communities and coastal, what we're doing is we're creating peasants, a whole generation of peasants from these women who labor for 12 hours a day and they get less than they would if they sold
actually,
the market.
If you don't encourage canneries,
the tuna industry is actually exploiting women in this country, and that needs to be highlighted.
And, you know, the cheapest form of labor in the Pacific are these women who stand in boots for 12 hours at the loining, you know, the cannery lines. You know, we all know. They make much less than they can survive on. They make enough to buy shampoo for their hair.
You know, Nancy, how they say, like, you know, we're providing jobs, and then, oh, well, most of the jobs are going to women, and it sounds good.
It
sounds great, but, you know, those women are being exploited.
If you talk to Pete Celso and the people, they say, look, they say, look, they're lining up. We always have fresh, because they drop out after a month. They go, I can't do this anymore.
You try to go and close a canary door. Who's going to complain? Is it going to be Pete Celso, or is it going to be the population there?
It's going to be Pete Celso, because he's made $270
million out of it. You're going to displace 4,000 people from a single canary.
Because if you can start up other spin-offs, he gave spin-offs to Kanalam and took them back. If you could find out other downstream processing industry, you know, spin-offs.
Yeah.
And if you can, can get more money into the NFA training and monitoring system, I think the industry is underexploited on many ways.
I'll stop you there, because there's one interesting thing that Pete Celso has to deal with, and that is that he is now having to employ women.
Yeah.
Almost 3 hours drive away from the plant.
You know why? Nobody else will work for him. What are you talking about? Why? And then he has to get Highlands women who've been kicked out because of domestic violence. They come tumbling down, and he creates dormitories for them on their land, on Kananam land, illegally. I'm sorry. Don't even get me started.
We're not here to bash Adi Tuna. Okay, we're going to move on.
May I say the... So we have been working with PNG government for the latest 5 years or so on different issues that they have to put in place. Mainly is this meaning reforms in policies, in procedures, in monitoring and surveillance systems, in traceability, in quality, and many other issues. And in the latest years, the progress has been very slow. So as a part of this framework, they have been informing in a regular basis that they might have this kind of yellow card. Well, what is the yellow card? It's color terminology. It's based in universals. I mean, it's an administrative language.
Yeah, it says we're not managing our tuna.
But it's based in universals. It's kind of the traffic lights.
It's a traffic light.
When the yellow, you say the yellow is that you have to make precaution.
That's what it says.
And when you have the red, is that you have to stop. But it's a bit the same. It's meaning that the yellow mean the government has not been making progress enough and has not been fast enough in the progress.
From the cheers coming from our very fine audience today, that something needs to change in this industry.
Yeah,
we're not doing enough. We're not even feeding our people, and we're not even getting enough returns, an equitable return from the fisheries. I think that's consistent from what the panel is saying. It's pretty good then that we're talking about being responsible in this agenda. We're talking about making it sustainable, and mostly for our people, mm-hmm. and our women in particular. Mm-hmm. Nancy, I hear you. And on that note, Papua New Guinea, thank you very much for watching Tanim Graun. I want you to join me in thanking our panel. Of course, we've had a very lively discussion. I start with John again. Thank you coming all the way from New Ireland.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Mr. Narakobi, for your vast experience and sharing with us this afternoon, thank you very much.
Sorry.
Nancy, I think we have to bring you to Port Moresby. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
NFA, for the fine work and for finally changing your direction after 20 years. Thank you for joining us today. We want to thank you, Maria. Convey our thanks to the European Union for giving us the yellow card. We needed it. Thank you very much. And of course, Martin, I think you need a haircut. Thank you for being with us. Thank you, Papua New Guinea. And remember, join us next time for Tanim Graun. Na tingim. Tok tok blong you by Tanim Graun. Thank you very much. Thank you.